Thank you to our sponsor, The Elmwood. The Elmwood is St. Louis Park's new apartment building. Designed for those 55 and better, it offers maintenance-free living so you can get out and enjoy your life and spend time doing what matters most. The Elmwood is located at 5605 West 36th Street in St. Louis Park. For information or to thank them for their sponsorship of this class, call 952-999-0023 or email elmwood@APTSbyMainStreet.com. You can also visit them at www.elmwoodliving.com. Hello, I'm Bob DeFlores, film historian, archivist, and I'm here today to entertain you with some vintage motion pictures. Due to the pandemic and the crisis that we're going through, movie-going experience was very popular during the Depression when things were down. 80 million people a week went to the theater, and they sat in the theater and were able to fantasize, and it brought their spirits up, and it helped the Depression era. All of us remember when we were younger, especially for the seniors anyway, when you went to the neighborhood theater and you saw the double feature, the cartoon, the short, a travelogue, or maybe even a musical short. And these were the times where you could actually stay in the theater and see the show all over again. So you got a lot for your money back then. And I remember my father taking me to the Saturday matinee in Hollywood. It was called the Pix Theater. And there was a line of kids halfway around the block to get in to see The Serial and Laurel and Hardy and all those wonderful shorts and cartoons. And so this was a big thing for me and kids of my era. And I'm sure a lot of you out there feel the same way. Movies bring back a lot of fantasy world adventures, and I think during this time of the pandemic, we need that. We need that bad. Our program today is just like the old days. We have the cartoon, which is Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. It's a Max Fleischer cartoon. He also did Betty Boop, Popeye the Sailor, Out of the Inkwell series. It's in beautiful Technicolor. This is the newly restored copy. The short is extremely rare. Very few people have seen this short. And I must tell you the story of how that was found. A young college student in Iowa was going through an old movie theater, and he found a can of film and a poster. And he read an article about me preserving motion pictures and interested in restoring motion pictures. And so he drove up from Iowa, and I hope it wasn't just to see me, but his family. He gave me the can of film and the poster, and that's our short for the day called The Fifth Freedom. And it's beautiful Technicolor, and it's produced by the Chesterfield Cigarettes. So you're going to see on this short subject, Arthur Godfrey, Bob Hope, Perry Como, and Bing Crosby. And it's a wonderful little short. This is for you to see. These are the type of things that I like to bring and show. Our major feature is the newly restored second chorus with Fred Astaire, Burgess Meredith, Paulette Goddard. It's got wonderful character actors in it. A couple dances by Fred Astaire and also Paulette Goddard. What's interesting about this film, when you look back at some of the early books when it was released, Burgess Meredith and Fred Astaire are supposed to be college kids in a college band who want to join Artie Shaw and his orchestra. But at that time, Fred Astaire was 41 years old, and Burgess Meredith is 33. Paulette Goddard at the time was in the midst of a divorce with Charlie Chaplin. So not too long after the movie was finished, her and Burgess Meredith married. The interesting thing also beside that is that when Fred Astaire is playing the trumpet or miming the trumpet, that is Bobby Hackett, a famous jazz musician. When Burgess Meredith is playing the trumpet, that's Billy Butterfield, who's also a famed musician. At the end of the movie, towards the end, they do some close-ups on the actual Artie Shaw Orchestra, and one of the musicians standing is Billy Butterfield, the one that plays for Burgess Meredith. So it's a fun movie. It's not one of Fred Astaire's favorite movies. He didn't know for sure whether Paulette Goddard could do what Ginger Rogers had done, but still, she did a wonderful job and it was accepted. And so Artie Shaw looked at himself on the screen. He made a few movies out in Hollywood. And he thought, boy, my acting days are limited. It should be over. And the interesting thing was, in 1940, same year this movie was filmed, Ginger Rogers won Academy Award for Kitty Foyle. Fred Astaire called her up to congratulate her, and all he said on the phone was, ouch, which meant his movie or his appearances without her didn't command that award. So anyway, let's go ahead and sit back, relax, and enjoy the movie, second chorus, and the shorts. Thank you.
You know Dasher and Dancer and Prancer and Vixen, Comet and Cupid and Donner and Blitzen.
But do you recall the most famous reindeer of all? Rudolf the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose, and if you ever saw it, you would even say it glows. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. They never let poor Rudolf join in any reindeer games. Then one foggy Christmas Eve, Santa came to say,
Rudolf, with your nose so bright,
won't you guide my sleigh tonight? Then how the reindeer loved him as they shouted out with glee, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, you'll go down in history.
'Twas the day before Christmas, and all through the hills the reindeer were playing, enjoying the spills of skating and coasting and climbing the willows and hopscotch and leapfrog, protected by pillows.
His nose is a sight. It's red as a beet.
Twice as big and twice as bright. Looky, looky, I'm Rudolph.
Poor Rudolph. Where most reindeer's noses are brownish and tiny, Rudolph's was red, very large and quite shiny.
Red Nose, your mama's calling you.
Come, come, Rudolph. Tonight you hang up your stocking.
Mm-hmm.
knows the sight. It's red as a beet.
Twice as big, twice as bright.
While way, way up north on this dark, foggy night, awaiting the time for his Christmas Eve flight, good old Santa.
This fog will be hard to get through. Quick, get hitched in a hurry. Dasher, Dancer, Prancer, Vixen, Comet, Cupid, Donner, Blitzen. Hi-ho! To keep our direction, we'll have to fly low. Come down here, quick! Foggy, the night dark and drear when Santa arrived at the home of the deer. But all this took time and filled Santa with gloom while slowly he groped toward the next reindeer's room. The lamp wasn't burning. The glow came instead from Rudolph's red nose at the head of the bed. And then came the greatest idea in all history. So Rudolph is told of the dark and delay, the fog and the blackness and losing the way. I need you tonight to lead all my deer on the rest of our flight.
Dear Mommy and Daddy, I have gone to help Santa. Don't worry, Rudolph, that's me.
Hurry, Rudolph, it's very dark here.
With Rudolph's red nose as a wonderful light, old Santa flew quickly the rest of the night. That before it was day, the very last present was given away.
Hear ye, a message from Rudolph.
Yes, they'd found Rudolph's message. It's all over town.
Hear ye, Rudolph at the stadium. Come on, come on.
Bad deer who used to do nothing but tease him? Well, now they'd do anything only to please him.
Rudolph, my boy, they'll envy you now, far and near, for no greater honor can come to a deer than riding with Santa and guiding my sleigh
the number one job on the number one day. I hope you'll continue to keep us from grief. I hereby appoint you Commander-in-Chief.
And Rudolf just blushed from his head to his toes until his whole fur was as red as his nose.
Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night.
Then all the reindeer loved him as they shouted out with glee. Rudolf the red-nosed reindeer, you'll go down in history.
In no other nation are so many millions free from want and from fear. Nor is there anywhere greater respect for man's right to worship as he believes, or to speak the truth as he sees it.
So if you want to satisfy the one you love, all else above, take a tip and be sure you try the ukulele style. Yes, the ukulele style of making love. You know, sometimes I think that we don't know how fortunate we are. Just look around the house. Electric lights, bathroom, a telephone, heat if you're cold, air conditioning if you can afford it. But the best part of living in America is the fact that we've got five freedoms. Five freedoms. And the fifth one is the most important. You know what it is? Freedom of choice. That's it. You are the boss. You're the boss of most everything. You can choose what you want, from toothpaste to wallpaper. Nobody's saying you can't read this book. This newspaper is forbidden. And unless a manufacturer pleases you and a lot of others like you, he pretty soon goes out of business. Even in entertainment. You didn't have to come to this theater tonight. You could go where you wanted to. You don't have to look at any certain television show. You could take a hold of that switch and shift to any channel you like. You're the boss even of your own pleasure.
Whether American by birth or by choice, none can escape the responsibility of continuing unbroken a heritage rich in liberty and in freedom. Because generations of Americans have, in their turn, preserved and strengthened this birthright, today there are greater advantages and more opportunities for all. The study of recorded knowledge and the experience of the past often reveals new knowledge, which can be used to fashion greater achievement in the future. And students are becoming aware that the basic concept of all freedoms, freedom of choice, has guided our nation and our people throughout American history. For this freedom, the United States was founded. With this freedom, a nation was built. And by this freedom, it has grown great. One of the rich rewards of freedom is the American industrial system. To survive, let alone prosper, the industrialist must meet the high standards of the consumer. For example, the manufacturer of your cigarette must know the quality of the tobacco grown on every farm in tobacco land. He must select not only the choicest, but also the mildest tobacco that money can buy. He must maintain vast facilities for storing this fine tobacco, so that there will be enough to meet the increasing demand. In the most modern factory in all tobacco land, the choice, fully ripe leaves are blended to create the right combination of the world's best tobaccos.
Because the manufacturer knows that his success depends upon the American public choosing his product, every step of production is directed toward making a cigarette that gives more smoking pleasure. In the research laboratory, a staff of scientists checks and rechecks every phase of manufacture, seeking new ways to make your cigarette ever milder and better tasting. But final judgment of every manufacturer's product rests with the consumer, the independent U.S. citizen, who alone decides what is best suited to his taste and pocketbook. Most of the advantages of the privilege of choosing and deciding for oneself are found in the American home. The home is under the protection of a government chosen by and responsible to the people themselves. Within the home are the rewards of a land where freedom has created progress, and progress has served man. Whatever our failures and our shortcomings, no other great nation enjoys such a high standard of living, nor have so many people so much to be thankful for.
Bless these windows shining bright, letting in God's heavenly light. Bless the hearth ablazing there with smoke ascending like a prayer.
Bless the folk who dwell within, keep them pure and free from sin. Bless us all that we may be fit, O Lord, to dwell with thee.
Bless us all that one day we may dwell, O Lord, with thee.
Today, free men know that great sacrifices must be made if we are to preserve our many freedoms. When a free nation mobilizes its might and manpower, there is always a need for men of special talent. Of gifted men, none is anywhere more welcome than the artist from the world of entertainment.
You know, as soon as I get back to Paramount, we're making another road picture. I think it's the last of the roads. We're going to work on the alleys next. And you folks have been wonderful here. You have a wonderful camp. These waves are great. I love the waves. You know what a wave is? That's an old salt with a new shaker. Yes, sir. But isn't it wonderful, this armed forces of ours, the freedom and the choice that you get in our army? You have your choice of anything. You can have your spam any way you want. But freedom is like life insurance. You pay for it as long as you live. And our American way of life is freedom's best insurance policy. Are we going to keep up the premiums or let it lapse? The fifth freedom, freedom of choice, gives us no choice but to make more planes, tanks, and guns, make more sacrifices, and pay more taxes. Yes, sir, our kind of freedom has a pretty heavy price tag on it. But, mister, you can shop anywhere in the world and you can't find a better buy, believe me.
Like others before them, citizens of the great American Republic are taking up arms to preserve and defend the principle the nation has lived by and must continue if man is to achieve a future on this earth.
Grand old flag, you're a high-flying flag, and forever in peace may you wave. You're the emblem of the land I love, home of the free and the brave. Every heart beats true under red, white, and blue, where there's never a boast or a brag. But should old acquaintance be forgot, keep your eye on the grand old flag.
The best trumpet player this college ever had.
Let's get closer.
I thought you'd like the music.
Just saying the other day, I ought to see more of Walt Stew.
Well, we better go sit down or something, Ellen. See you later.
Your playing was wonderful.
Thanks.
You don't think she meant you, do you?
You don't think she meant you, do you?
Wait a minute. You don't think she'd fall for that station house music of yours?
Listen, it's not so much my music, it's my personality, I'll show you.
Hello, Stu.
Oh, Mr. O'Neill, won't you join?
Oh, thank you. See you later, son. Well, Stu, do you want something?
Me? No, no, no.
I've been wanting to meet you for some time, Mr. O'Neill.
Well, that's wonderful. You mean you like the band?
Oh, I didn't mean that I wanted to meet the band exactly, although I thought they did back you up rather well.
Thanks. Is there any special number you'd like to hear?
I would like to hear the Call Me Up and Call Me Down Blues.
The what?
The Call Me Up and Call Me Down Blues.
Oh, I know what you mean. I'm afraid I haven't got the number.
Oh, I'm sure you'll be able to get a hold of it.
Why don't you go back to the bandstand and look for it?
Oh, no hurry, Stu. Such a long time since you and I have got together, I want to make the most of it. It's heartwarming, that's what it is. Nothing like old college friends, I always say. All for one, and all for one. Yes, sir. I think I better be getting back. So long, Stu.
So long.
All right, boys, number 9.
Ha, 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 ha.
Why can't you go on a picnic?
Mr. Dunn is inside, Mr. Taylor.
Mr. Dunn? Mr. Dunn wouldn't be any fun on a picnic.
Look, this is a collection agency, not an escort bureau. Now, will you please get off my desk?
Is this fellow annoying you, Miss Miller? Hello. Hello. Well, I just seeing Miss Miller here about the encyclopedias. See, I figure I can take care of the details. As Miss Miller was kind enough to serve me with the summons, I'll explain the details.
What is there to explain? 7 years ago, you bought a set of encyclopedias for which you've never paid.
But I didn't buy them.
Please, you're wasting my time.
See that, Danny? You're wasting Miss Miller's time. As I was saying, 7 years ago, I must have broken a mirror because that walked in and became my roommate. I was only a simple freshman at the time.
What are you now, a simple sophomore?
Oh, now, Miss Miller, you're being a bit unkind. After all, we've worked hard to stay in college this long.
He's right. Now, it's not easy for a couple of bright guys like us to go on flunking year after year.
What in the world are you talking about?
Well, it's like this. You see, as long as we can stay in college, the band makes us a very comfortable living.
That's right. $5,000-$6,000 a year. Now, that's more than you can make on Wall Street.
Besides, it's a nice life. Cultural, relaxing, gay. But getting back to the subject, this roommate, whom I trusted implicitly, ordered a set of encyclopedias in my name.
That's gratitude. It was a birthday present. You were crazy about him.
I was crazy about him until I got the bill.
Miller! What's this?
Mr. O'Neill, Mr. Taylor, Mr. Dunn.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes! Step right in.
Now, look, Mr. Dunn, here's the situation. We're temporarily embarrassed.
See, we're working our way through college.
Just college kids, you know.
You've been working your way through college for the last 7 years.
Well, now, it takes time.
Especially when you're struggling.
Boys, you don't pull any wool over me. You ain't broke. You ain't struggling.
You mean you doubt our word?
You said it. I've got your number. You're businessmen. Now, pay up or go to jail. That's final.
Final, eh?
Final.
Final.
Well, maybe we ought to ask for an extension.
Yeah.
Hit it.
Okay,
hey,
Dunsy
boy.
We do make money.
That's it. We haven't got any right
just
now.
Just give us 1 month.
Just 1 month's extension. Okay, Dunsy.
I won't listen.
Why, we'll be around.
What do you think we are? Fly by night?
My word is as good as my bond.
Doesn't he, Dunsy?
Everybody in town knows.
Have that money here tomorrow. I'll see you in court. No.
No.
That's a sordid little fella, isn't he? Sordid little place. Must be a sordid life for such a lovely girl.
Well, there's nothing so sordid about it, except the people we deal with.
It's a pity we can't take Miss Miller out of this.
Yes, how'd you like some fresh air?
Sorry. I have work to do.
She's very businesslike, isn't she?
Yeah.
I like that in a secretary. In fact, I'd like to have a secretary like that. You know, there's an awful lot of work running a band.
Come to think of it, we do need a secretary.
But I don't need a job.
So she doesn't need a job.
Huh? Mm-hmm.
Whatever it is, I won't do it. Now, I want to tell you...
Now, look, Mr. Dunn, I want to do the right thing. We don't care anything about the encyclopedia company.
No, we care about you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, well... Well, maybe I said a few hasty words, boys. Let bygones be bygones, eh? $2. But the bill's 110.
Well, that's for you to fix things up.
What are you talking about? Are you asking me to take a bribe? A $2 bribe?
Oh, now, come, Don. We're all men of the world, you know.
We'll keep it on our hands.
Don't worry. You can depend on us. She'll tell you.
She? Who?
Miss Miller.
Miss Miller.
Miss Miller! Come in here, please. Did you intimate to these gents that I could be bribed?
She didn't say you could be bribed. She said you could be fixed.
Why, Mr. Dunn, I didn't say any such thing.
Oh, yes, you did.
Of course you did, Miss Miller.
She didn't want us to tell you.
Don't believe him, Mr. Dunn.
Miss Miller, I heard you myself.
Didn't you hear her? I did.
We both heard her.
Wait a minute. I'll have you deadbeats put in jail, and it's for you, Miss Miller. You're fired.
Oh.
Thanks a lot, old man.
Thanks a lot.
Miss Miller.
Haven't you Rover boys caused enough trouble already?
It was really a kindly gesture.
A very kindly gesture. Now I haven't even a reference.
But I don't demand a reference.
We know you're for what you are.
Yes.
You mean you really want me to work for you?
Sure. Wouldn't you like to?
What's your salary?
18 a week.
He'll double it.
Yeah.
Well.
Hit it.
Now, let me tell you.
Here's the chance of a lifetime.
We're going to offer you the greatest
opportunity you've ever had in your life.
We're going to take you out of the game.
All right. I'll take it.
Good.
When do I start?
Right now.
Well, now that I'm working for you, I'll tell you something. Dunn can be bought, but his price isn't $2, it's $10.
Here, you want to take care of the details. Hey! Well, here we are. You can have half that desk, quarter of that rack, and just go to work.
There's only one detail that you've omitted. What are my duties?
Oh, you type a little.
Telephone a little.
Keep the leader happy.
Keep your eye on the brass section.
I thought you said this was a job.
Oh, lining up good engagements is no cinch.
What's so difficult about it? Operator, get me the Riverdale Country Club.
Oh, no,
no, you can't get that date. We've already tried.
Who's in charge there?
Mr. Bent, isn't it?
Bent, real sourpuss.
Hello, Mr. Bent? This is Mr. O'Neill's secretary. No, Mr. Danny O'Neill, the orchestra leader. I read in the paper that you're planning a Halloween dance. Bob Harvey's Cornell Clippers. Oh, but we entertain, too. Do we entertain?
No, but we can dream up something.
Oh, our entertainment's terrific. That's our strong point. Mr. Bent, until you've seen the perennials, you haven't lived. Oh, it isn't that I don't admire Emil Coleman, but isn't his music a little, shall we say, rowdy? Now, Mr. O'Neill's salon ensemble play everything gently, but with a lilt, and all his boys are from such nice families.
Very well. We'll expect them at 7:30.
Thank you. Believe me, Bud, my outfit are killers. Just what you need for one-nighters.
Can they pack him in like Dorsey?
Solid Jack.
Murder.
Furthermore, I could come down a day before the dance and help you with the decorations. That is, of course, if you want me to.
Wait a minute, Ben. We took a poll on the campus and almost everybody voted for Artie Shaw's band.
Artie Shaw? Who's Artie Shaw?
Yeah.
Glass of water, please.
Yes, sir.
Now, what about that prom? Is it set?
Not exactly, Chief.
They hired that college band.
Danny O'Neill's Perennials.
O'Neill again, huh?
This is the fourth time we've run into them on college dates.
Either they got a great band or a fine manager. I gotta go up and hear them sometime.
I wouldn't worry about them, Chief. They'll be graduating in another week.
Not the Perennials.
It's okay, boys, okay. No graduation this year. I flunked three courses.
Oh, Danny, you're wonderful.
Well, Danny, old boy, we made it again, huh?
What's the matter?
Well, Hank, I don't quite know how to tell you.
What do you mean, I passed? Oh, listen, I couldn't graduate, not with my marks. What, are you kidding me? Oh, listen, there must be some mistake. I'm not going to take this lying down. I'm going to see the dean about it. They can't do this to me.
Oh, Danny.
Poor old Hank. He got careless.
You didn't have anything to do with this, did you?
Why, Ellen. Of course, a little peace and quiet won't hurt either of us.
But poor Hank.
You still have me. I guess we'll just have to carry on as good old Hank would have wanted us to.
It seems to me...
It seems to you?
I said it seems to me.
You said it seems to you?
Seems to me I smell a mouse.
somewhere about the house. It seems to me.
It seems to you?
I said it seems to me.
You said it seems to you.
That such an embarrassing situation calls for concentration. Do you dig me, Jack?
We dig you, Jack.
Can you think of a plan?
We solid again.
To get me out of this mess?
Yes.
We'll start the music and play it back.
Solid, Jack.
Solid, Jack.
Sing and dance.
I'll take a chance.
Are your boots on right?
I got them laced up tight.
Is Miss Miller a killer?
From a Spanish villa.
Is her dancing mellow?
Why, mellow as a cello.
Then it seems to me, obviously, you want to go right into your curtsy curry.
What will it be?
Don't look at me.
Now let me see. What will it be? I never could do the conga. Could never get through the conga. But if you say do the conga, I ain't hep to that step, but I'll dig it. I never could see mazurkas. They're poison to me, mazurkas. But if it's to be mazurkas, I ain't hep to that step, but I'll dig it.
When they invented the Charleston, he was a total flop.
Right. But say, if you want a Charleston, I'll never stop or dance till I drop.
Yeah.
I never could dig the polka. The corniest jig, the polka. But if you say dig the polka, I ain't hep to that step, but I'll dig it.
Hey,
that's it.
Ah, here you go.
Anywhere with the dean?
No. Seems that article I wrote on the decline of the harpsichord and her sister instruments was what really put me across.
That's so?
Yeah. You know, it's a funny thing. I don't even remember writing that article. And yet the dean said it was so good he couldn't possibly think of flunking me.
Tough luck.
Yeah.
Cheer up, boy. It's probably all for the best. Say, what do you got there?
What's that?
What's that?
Encyclopedia.
Oh. Think of it, Hank. You'll go into your father's textile business, a cog in a great industry, stamping your personality on miles and miles of tweed, making the wheels turn, punching the clock, listening to the song of the looms. What volume is that?
It's, Ham to Ilk. Why?
Oh, nothing. Music wasn't for you, Hank. You could never have got anywhere with that beat-up trumpet of yours. Your medium is textiles. Your father was a textile man, so was his father before him. Why, you've got wool in your blood, Hank. What's the bookmark for?
Oh, it's an article there. Rather interested the dean. Yes, you know, funny thing about that article, it's almost identical with my thesis.
Interesting coincidence.
Yeah, that's what the dean thought. You know, I had quite a time trying to persuade him that the marginal notes weren't mine. As a matter of fact, I tried to convince him that the handwriting wasn't yours.
Yeah?
Yeah.
What'd he say?
He said you were fired.
You dog.
Ah, take it easy, Danny.
You low, conniving dog.
You two will have to face the world, fall right into your father's concrete. You'll be a cog within a cog. You can't get away from it, Danny, my boy. You got concrete in your bones.
Danny! Hank! Hurry! Wonderful news! Hurry! Look, telegram. We'll be in town Saturday. We'd like to look over your outfit. Artie Shaw.
Say, well, there it is. That's it. Shaw wants to look me over.
Look you over. Look us over.
All right, us. Huh. Seems to be in a kind of a rush about it. I wonder how soon he want me to start.
Say, it didn't take him long to find out that I'd be available, did it?
You'll be available indefinitely, I'm afraid.
Yeah, now then, first thing tomorrow, I must find Ellen a new job.
Don't bother. As soon as I get set, I'll send for you.
Oh, that's very kind of you.
All right, now, come on, let's get organized. Call the boys and tell them to be there early. Summer uniforms, and you go home and run your scales. Come on.
Don't bury it. I'll be out in a few minutes.
Artie Shaw!
Artie Shaw, he's here.
Good, thanks.
Hey, what about the buck you promised me?
All right, all right. Beat it.
Okay, gang. Sweet Sue.
Psst, Hank. Sure. He's coming in now.
Swell. Thanks, pal.
Come on, give out. I'll bring you some change.
Now, a nice, easy background on this one, boys.
Hey, Danny, why don't you lay out this one? Save your lip till Shaw comes. I'll take the lead.
Are you kidding?
I'm okay. I've been in the woodshed.
You've been in the cornfield. All right, boys. One, two.
You're pitching in there.
Gee, thanks, Mr. Shaw.
And on straight salary or percentage?
What a percentage.
Smart, huh?
Thanks again, Mr. Shaw.
Where's Mr. Miller?
Mr. Miller?
Yeah, the manager of the band.
Oh, that Mr. Miller. There she is. This is Mr. Shaw, Mr. Miller.
We've been expecting you, Mr. Shaw.
Swell. If you're not too busy, I'd like to talk to you for a few minutes.
Fine.
I'd like to, but I'm on my way down to Trenton to play a date. Anyway, it was nice talking.
Thanks, and good night.
Good night.
Thanks.
No trouble.
Where is he?
He's gone.
Gone?
Where's Shaw? What did he say?
He's gone. You ruined it.
What are you talking about? I was terrific. When do I start?
Take 10, son. What was his proposition?
Well, his proposition rather surprised me.
Oh, quibbled about salary, huh?
Wait a minute. I don't work on Sundays.
Look, Ellen, what gives? When do I start?
You don't.
What? Well, then what did he want?
Me.
Ellen, I hate to see you go.
Well, I hate to go, Danny.
I kind of hope that,
What, Danny?
Oh, nothing. I guess it was just silly, that's all.
No, it wasn't. What was it?
Excuse me. You're sprouting. Here's the popcorn, Sonny. Hold it for the lady. Here's your ticket, Ellen. Come on, I'll tell the conductor where to let you off. And be a good girl and don't talk to any strange man.
I won't, and then I'll see you in New York?
I hope so. Well, I don't know. You know, Portland's a long way from New York, and concrete kind of holds a man down.
Well, you'll be there, Hank.
No, as a matter of fact, I've got to pay a lot of attention to those mills in Fall River.
Well, I won't be seeing either of you?
No.
Well, I'm afraid not.
Oh, goodbye, you idiot.
Look out for her orchids for you.
Goodbye.
Start for Portland.
Right. When do you leave for Fall River?
About an hour.
I'll see you off.
No, don't bother. You got to pack.
Yeah. Well, this is it.
Right. So long, Danny.
So long, kid. It's been a lot of fun.
You bet it has. Now, take care of yourself.
I'll drop you a line.
Do that.
Under the impression that this was an important affair. Oh, it is. Oh, well, in that case, I know you'll want Mr. Shaw. That's fine, thank you.
Couple of relatives. Well, what's cooking, Ellen?
We closed the Atlantic City job on our own terms.
Oh, that's swell.
And the intercollegiate prom.
Not a bad 2 days' work. Looks like my hunch about you was pretty good.
I'm glad. Mr. Shaw, I wonder if I could ask you a favor.
Of course.
It's about a couple of trumpet players.
Oh, well, you see, I always pick my own men, Ellen, and I don't...
Of course, but all I want you to do is to hear these boys. They're marvelous.
Well, where are they, around town?
Practically. One's in Portland and the other's in Fall River, but they could be here in a jiffy.
Isn't that a lot of traveling just for an audition?
Oh, but they wouldn't mind. And once you hear them, you'll know what I mean.
Well, if you think they're that good, I'll listen to them.
Thank you.
Not at all.
Call the Western Union boy to pick up 2 telegrams. Thank you.
What floor is Artie Shaw on?
17th.
Going up. Forward, buddy.
What floor is Artie Shaw on?
17th.
Aren't you going to Fall River the hard way? I suppose this elevator stops at Portland.
No, sir. Last stop is the 22nd floor.
So you were going to give a lot of time to the mill.
Listen, I got as much right here as you have.
Why don't you face facts, Hank? Ellen's not even established yet. She can't possibly get us both in the band.
I'm going to get a tryout with Artie Shaw. I have to tear down this building floor by floor.
17th floor next.
Here's a present for you, Sam.
Have one on me, Sam.
Excuse me.
Where's Artie Shaw's office, please?
Right that way.
Oh, thanks. How do you do? Mr. Taylor, Miss Miller, please.
Miss Miller is very busy right now.
Hey, is that a
3 or a 5? Well,
she'll see me.
She'll see me. I'm in the same college
together. Hey, is that 34 or 54 Highcroft Road?
34.
Hey, wait a minute. What do you got there?
Why, this is for me.
Yeah. Hank, Shaw's sending for me.
Me, too. You know, I knew he'd get around to that sooner or later.
Any answers?
We'll take care of the answers, bud. Yeah.
Thanks.
It's all right.
What do you make of this?
Look at that Fall River.
Say. Excuse me.
Something funny about this.
Yeah.
He walked out on us at the prom, didn't he?
Yeah.
You don't suppose it was deliberate?
Why would he? You mean he wanted us to cool our heels for a while so we'd work for peanuts? Listen, we're not that hard to get.
No, but then he got Ellen down here as a decoy, thinking we'd work for nothing on account of her.
That's it? How do you like it?
I don't like it. He can't treat a friend of ours like that.
No, sir.
I'll fix him. Just for that, I'm going to ask for $25 a week more.
50.
Young lady, you can tell Shaw that we'll see him.
Mr. Shaw is very different.
Never mind, we'll tell him. Thanks. Come on, Hank.
Hey, wait a minute.
Hi, Shaw.
Now, just a minute, fellas. You'll have to wait outside.
I'm the new trumpet player you just sent for.
Yeah, me, too. We just got your wire.
What? Oh, yeah. Well, you certainly took your time getting here.
Well, we had a couple of other offers to consider.
All right, boys. I'll tell you what you do. Drop down to the hotel tonight and play a couple of tunes with the band. Huh?
That'll be swell. I'd
love to. See you then. I'm sorry. I'm pretty busy now.
Well, that's all right. Which is Miss Miller's office?
Right across the hall.
Well, thanks. Think I'll have a little talk with her.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, Artie.
Ellen.
Danny, I can't believe my eyes. Oh, it's so good to see you.
Kind of surprised you, huh?
And Hank, wherever did you come from?
Artie Shaw's office. We were just talking a little business.
But Portland.
Portland's loss is your gain.
And Fall River?
Fall River will have to suffer, too.
Did Artie say anything about giving you a tryout?
Oh, sure.
Oh, darlings, that's wonderful.
Yes, but we haven't promised him anything yet. Straight ahead.
Hey there.
Good evening, Cap. I'm the new trumpet player with Artie Shaw.
I ain't never seen you before.
It's all right. You're going to see plenty of me from now on. Oh, by the way, if my brother happens to drop around here tonight, tell him that Shaw's not giving any more auditions, see? If he makes a fuss, just throw him out. You know how these little family jealousies are. Thanks.
What's your name?
Danny O... O'Taylor.
I'm glad you got here early.
I was lonesome. I haven't seen you since late this afternoon. Not a bad house. How long are we booked here for?
You're only booked for one number.
This audition? Mere formality.
Where's Hank?
Hank? How do I know? Am I my brother's keeper?
I thought he was coming with you.
He probably got cold feet. Couldn't face the humiliation of being turned down. Poor boy. I wish I could do something to help him.
Oh, yes.
Oh, now, Ellen, I'm very fond of Hank. After all, he did bring us together. If it hadn't been for those encyclopedias, I might never have met you. I'll always be grateful to him for that. Won't you?
Danny, this is no time.
Yes, it is. This is just the time. Yesterday, what was I? A carefree schoolboy. Today, what? A man with his career assured. A man with plans for the future.
Danny, don't you think you ought to be warming up?
I've been warmed up a long time. Ellen. Shall I take the vocal?
Would you like to be the love of my life for always and always? Watch over me to square my blunders and share my dreams. One day with caviar, next day a chocolate bar. Would you like to take the merry-go-round? I'll need you. I need you. Just wait till you see. I hope in your horoscope there is room for a dolt who adores you. that would make the only dream of my life come true. For the love of my life is you.
Ellen.
So I'm your brother, huh?
I was afraid you wouldn't make it.
You shouldn't worry about me, Brother Danny.
Ellen, I think you better leave.
No, stick around.
What happened, Hank?
Brother Danny here framed me with a doorman.
All I wanted was to be alone with you for once.
See that? He admits the whole thing.
Oh, now, wait a minute.
You know that doorman hit me in the lip?
He did?
Yeah.
Oh, that's too
bad. How'd you like to even it up, huh?
Oh, now, wait.
How'd you like that?
No, boys, please, you have to go on in a minute. You're putting me in an awful position. Now, come on, let's forget it. I'll tell Artie you're here. Good luck, darlings.
Darlings.
You haven't forgotten the two trumpet players.
No, I'll be right with you. I'll put your boys on the next set, but first give me a hand with that character over there. He's been here 10 nights in a row. He's an awful ear bender.
Well.
Mr. Chisholm, this is Miss Miller.
How do you do, Miss Miller?
Well, sir, that last number jumped for you?
Oh, very peppy. Very peppy indeed. By the way, what chord did we finish on?
B-flat.
Sure, I missed it again. Won't you two join me?
I'm sorry, I've got to get back and play the next number, but Miss Miller can tell you all about the band.
Miss Miller hep, as you boys say?
Hep as they come.
Fascinating, your swing jargon. I'm becoming hep to it myself.
Well, see you later, Mr. Chisholm.
So long, gate. That's short for alligator. Please be seated.
Are you a musician, Mr. Chisholm?
Oh, I should have been, but I was forced to give it up. I said music, and Father said bottle caps. Father won.
Oh, what a pity. I take it that the banjo is your instrument.
Oh, no, the mandolin, the flatback mandolin.
All right, boys, you're on. What do you want to play?
How about I'm yours?
That's a pretty tough arrangement to play at sight.
I'll play anything that's on the paper.
Okay. How about you?
Pick one.
All right, I'll leave the book with you. Look them over.
Oh, Artie, on the question of who plays first, may I suggest alphabetical order in the interest of fairness?
Sure, okay. All right, we're on in about 3 minutes.
What's the matter? Aren't you going to look over your part?
I couldn't hit a bad note if I tried. Not tonight.
Why is tonight an exception?
Oh, I don't know. It makes all the difference in the world when you know there's someone depending on you.
What?
Oh, nothing. Nothing. Nothing at all.
Who's dependent on you?
Nobody. Forget it, Hank. Forget it.
Say, you were alone here with Ellen when I came in.
For almost the first time since I've known her.
Yeah? Well, what happened? What'd you say to her?
Look, Hank, Ellen and I don't suppose it's any concern of yours, but when I get set with Shaw, Ellen and I...
You proposed to her. What'd she say?
She just looked up at me and gave me her tender, unspoken yes.
How do you know it wasn't an unspoken no?
Fella can tell. It was one of those rare occasions when silence was more eloquent than words.
Yeah?
Yeah.
All right. That's the way it is. Wish you all the happiness in the world. Have me over for dinner sometime.
Thanks, Hank.
All right.
I'm glad you're not gonna let this come between us.
Danny boy.
Yeah.
Well, that was just dandy. I'll be sure and call you. And meanwhile, if anything else comes up, take it. You sure you know what you're doing?
Say the word.
Okay, fellas, here we go. One, two.
See what I mean? I've even got music in my feet.
O'Neill's Perennials.
Never heard of them.
Have you heard of Artie Shaw?
Well, were you associated with him?
Associated with him? Why, I made a deeper impression on him than any trumpet player he ever heard.
One moment, please.
Artie, there was one thing about last night. Maybe I shouldn't bring
now,
it
wait
up.
Wait a minute, if it's about those same
no, no,
two...
No, no, no. It was about Mr. Chisholm. No, I mean it.
Yeah? Who? Him? Are you kidding? Well, throw him out.
Anything serious?
Nah.
Out.
All right.
Hello. Tell Tommy that Hank Taylor's here, will you?
Get off the desk.
Huh? All right.
Of course, Mr. Chisholm talks a lot, but he's sweet. He says he has the soul of an artist, but that his money's stifling it. Now, you've always wanted to give a concert. I know I can get him to back you.
How do I know he's any different from those crunchy, crinkled breakfast food guys? They've all got some angle.
All right, I'll guarantee to get him without one string attached.
No muss about what I should play?
None.
No bottle cap ads?
On a bright.
Okay, sounds swell if you can do it.
Good. I'll get to work on it right away.
Yeah? What? Him! Throw him out!
All right. Now, wait a minute. I got offers from Miller, Dukes, and Goodman. I got plenty of jobs. Don't say I didn't give you a chance.
I think I'll put a small wager on Magic Melody.
Oh, Lester, you're wonderful. Always willing to back something musical. Artists need a man like you.
You think so? Hunting song, I believe. My dear, are you choking? This place is one of my finds. They're all real musicians. Too bad they're not better known. Well, and do you remember what you said that I might be able to help?
Why can't I give these musicians to the world?
Oh, but your first duty is to the American artist.
Oh, yes, so it is.
Centuries of Slavic barons have gone into that dance.
Draining of some little girl on the steps of Russia. You can tell by his face he's loved and suffered.
And always watch over me or play a pick in a flock from the strings of your old balalaika.
Oh, please take me home. I can't stand
the love of my life. That I
can't tell you how much I appreciate you letting me back this concert, Mr. Shaw.
Not at all, not at all.
And how grateful I am to you, Ellen, to think after all these years I'm back in my true medium. By the way, how much did you say I should arrange for?
Roughly 15,000.
Well, wouldn't you say that 20 would be safer? After all, the name of J. Lester Chisholm must stand for nothing but the best.
There she goes, always thinking of me. I can't tell you what a jewel you have in this little girl.
I'm finding out every day.
And what an inspiration. You know, Mother actually thinks that every girl who is attracted to me is after the Chisholm money.
Come in. Oh, Lester.
Stay where you are. Don't move. You don't know what a picture you make there in the candlelight.
Lester, you've brought your mandolin.
For you?
Oh, you shouldn't.
Why not? Tonight's our night to celebrate, isn't it? I thought we might have a quiet evening of music. Just you and I, alone. I always say there's nothing like duets to make a home a home.
Can I use your house phone, please?
Certainly.
Thank you.
Who do you wish to speak to?
Miss Miller.
Who's calling?
Mr., Dunn.
Oh, Mr. Dunn.
Hello?
Hello, Ellen. It's me, Danny. I've been trying to get in touch with you. I'm downstairs and I thought maybe I could...
No, I can't see you tonight. No, no, I'm not being vindictive. I just can't see you. Of course Hank isn't here. Look, Danny, I'll have to talk to you tomorrow. No, he isn't.
Ellen, wait a minute.
Good night, Mr. Dunn.
Good night.
Mr. Dunn.
That was just an old college friend I was talking to. We won't be disturbed again, Lester.
Shall we continue while we're in the groove?
Flat?
No, I heard a noise. Is there someone in there?
Hardly. That's my bedroom.
Now, don't be nervous.
I'm not a bit nervous. See? Just as I told you, it's your imagination.
Much right under here as you have.
Yeah.
Say, if you're in here, I wonder who's out there.
That's right.
I thought it was you. Better investigate.
No, wait a minute. We don't want to upset Ellen today of all days.
That's right, not today.
So that's why you came up. I thought so.
What are you talking about?
I suppose you just happened to call on the day that Shaw announced his concert.
Well, I read something about the concert in the paper. But I'm much too busy to help Artie out. I'm working like a horse.
You're working?
Sure.
Not with Dorsey?
No. He wouldn't change his style to suit me. I've got a little engagement just out of town. I never had such a big audience.
Fourth trumpet, huh?
No, sir, boy. Strictly solo stuff. Why, is the concert the reason for your visit?
Who, me?
Yeah.
No, I'm much too busy for that.
Doing what?
After I quit Whiteman.
You quit Whiteman?
Sure. Too big a band for me. If I'd have stayed with him, I'd have lost my individuality. Same thing happened to Bix.
So you're unemployed, huh?
No, not at all. I just hooked up with a terrific European outfit. I never dreamed such things could be done to music.
Yeah? I wonder what's going on out there.
Sounds like she's giving somebody an audition.
I never heard of Shaw with a mandolin section.
What about a breather?
That's a wonderful idea.
Sometimes it's a little tiring.
Yes.
Let's have a toast to the concert. You know, Ellen, you've made me feel like a boy again.
Really, Les?
You've actually made me believe that money really isn't a handicap.
That's what I want you to believe.
I think after all these years, I have something to look forward to. Well, to our big night.
To our big night.
She's being taken advantage of.
She seems to be liking it.
I've seen that fella before.
Yeah?
Where was it? At the Russian res... The little bear.
The little wolf. I saw him with her at the racetrack.
We've got to get her out of this.
What are we waiting for?
You have another glass?
Oh, I don't think I should.
Well, you know best. That's what I admire about you, Ellen. You're so different from the other girls in this town.
Oh, I can hardly believe that, Lester.
You wouldn't. You're so innocent. You wouldn't believe the carryings-on. Oh, I've been told things. What's that? Somebody out there.
Oh, you're just imagining things again.
No, look.
Psst. What
the... He's not home, is he, Ellen?
Who is it? It's just a neighbor. He always wants to borrow the lawnmower or something. Excuse me. Danny, is it you?
Is that guy here again?
Pardon me, Mr. Chisholm.
Oh, Chisholm, yes. Ellen told me about you.
I guess she's getting rid of him. Well, she better. You know, I told her flatly. I said, it's either him or me. You know, I used to trust that guy. I went to college with him. I shared my room, my time, my troubles. But I won't share Ellen. You don't blame me, do you?
I didn't know. I think I better be going.
No, I didn't mean you. Stick around. Make yourself at home. You need anything?
No.
Glad I met you.
Oh, mercy.
Danny, how dare you come up here?
I'm glad I came up. I'm very glad.
Well, I'm not, and you get off this roof this instant.
Now, wait a minute. You need me, Ellen.
What?
Oh, I'm not blaming you for one moment, but...
What are you talking about?
He's not the kind of person to be around you. You don't know what you're getting into. Of course, it's not your fault. Hank and I both realize that.
Hank, is he here, too?
Oh, yes, he's inside, taking care of the details.
Good heavens.
Oh, dear.
Lester! Lester, wait a minute! Lester!
Why didn't you tell me you were married?
But I'm not married.
Then who is that man?
Oh, that was just Hank.
Ellen, I can't believe it. You of all people. Oh, dear, oh, dear.
Well, you mustn't be so upset. I'll send him away.
Now, don't make it worse, Ellen. I can't stand it. I can't stand it. I'm leaving for Cincinnati in the morning.
Cincinnati? But what about the concert?
Well, you can tell Mr. Shaw how much I appreciate the chance you gave me. Under the circumstances, I can't accept it.
Oh, but Lester, you can't throw away your whole musical career.
My musical career is over. Here. I'll never touch it again.
Oh, he says, I didn't know.
Poor Mr. Chisholm.
Poor Mr. Chisholm.
Poor Mr. Chisholm. Played on the mandolin. But he couldn't win, 'cause he tried to swing. And he broke a string every time.
Oh, he says, I better be going.
Poor Mr. Chisholm just couldn't
what?
Dig the jive. When he did arrive at the proper note, he...
Now, look, Ellen.
Now, this is all for the best.
What we did may have been a little drastic.
It may seem a little brutal at first.
But you'll thank us for it later.
So, I'll thank you for it. I suppose that Artie will thank you for it, too.
Artie? What do you mean, Artie?
What's Artie got to do with Mr. Chisholm?
Nothing. Nothing in the world. He was only the backer of the concert.
Concert?
All right, let's go again.
Shh.
There we go. Let's just play it over a few
seconds. Ellen, you've got to listen to me.
There's only one thing I've got to do. Go in there and tell Artie that the concert is off. Then leave town by the first train I can get.
Ellen, you can't. I'm awfully sorry about all this trouble. I wouldn't hurt you for the world. You know how I feel about you. Remember the other night, right here, when I took the vocal? I wasn't kidding.
There's one part I remember. The merry-go-round I'll lead you. You weren't kidding.
Oh, that's all over. The merry-go-round is out.
No, Danny, it's too late.
No, it isn't. Now, you just go in there and act as if nothing's happened, and I'll have Chisholm back here in an hour.
What can you do?
Don't worry about that. Just don't say anything to Shaw until I get back.
What can I say?
You can do it. Give me an hour.
All right, Danny. 1 hour.
That's right.
Hurry up, he's checking out.
What 20,000? Oh, that 20,000. Send it back to Cincinnati. I'm going back there myself.
On second thought, Joe, you just leave it where it is.
You bounder, leave this room immediately.
Mr. Chisholm, I brought you your mandolin.
I won't listen. Leave this room.
Now, take it easy, Chisholm. You're going to listen whether you want to or not. We've come to clear Ellen's name.
I won't hear her name mentioned in my presence.
Oh, now, don't say that, Mr. Chisholm.
Who are you?
I'm a man who wants to see justice done. All right, talk.
No, I can't.
Come clean.
All right. Mr. Chisholm, I have a confession to make. I've never done this before in my life. I lied to you.
Go on.
All right. Ellen is innocent.
Innocent? I saw with my own eyes.
He framed her, deliberately.
Impulsively. I am not Ellen's husband.
I know that.
What?
Yeah. Who are you?
Me?
He's her brother, Hank.
Aren't you ashamed?
Yeah.
Why did you endeavor to create this false impression?
I was trying to protect her.
Here. Now look here, Chisholm.
Wrong.
We didn't know who you were.
We didn't know how much you meant to her.
Well, you're just about the most important man in her life.
Right.
Oh, I didn't realize. Oh, what have I done?
You've acted shabbily.
You have misjudged a wonderful girl.
Jumped at brutal conclusions.
Oh, Oh, dear, do you think she'd ever forgive me?
Well, there's a chance, if you go about it in the right way.
Yes, if you crawl back to her on your hands and knees.
And beg her to forgive and forget.
Oh, I will. Oh, do you think this will interfere with letting me back the concert?
Well, I don't think so.
No, Ellen isn't small. But you better hurry.
Oh, I will. I'll get my hat and gloves. You make yourselves at home.
Poor Mr. Chisholm.
Well, we finally done right by our Ellen.
It's about time.
Yeah, makes you feel good, huh? You know, self-sacrifice, doing unto others.
That's the life.
Yeah, but a little self-sacrifice goes a long way.
We ought to think of our own careers for a change. After all, we are the intimate friends of Shaw's backer. Huh?
No, but we mustn't use Chisholm. Huh. We owe it to Ellen not to take any more chances.
No, Ellen won't respect a couple of failures.
It's true. If it wasn't for us, the concert would be off.
Certainly. He owes us a break.
Well, here I go. Boys, if there's ever anything I can do.
Nonsense, Mr. Chisholm. We're glad to do a good turn. If there's anything we can do for you.
Oh, you've already done enough.
Oh, I mean, like helping you select numbers for the concert and that sort of thing.
You see, I don't select the numbers for the concert. Why, I hardly dare venture an opinion.
Oh, but you should.
After all, I'm only the backer.
Only the backer? Why, Mr. Chisholm, you're the impresario, the most important man in the entire organization.
You've got to be the guiding hand.
Choose the music.
Pick the men.
It's your duty.
Think of the other backers. You're letting them down.
You're letting Shaw down.
Well, this is terrible. Why didn't anyone ever tell me this before? Why, I would have been delighted to do it.
It's not too late.
Not if you work fast.
I don't know just which way to start. What would you suggest?
Well, first of all, line up a number.
That's a good idea, but offhand, I can't think.
Oh, sure. You remember the Rolling Back to Mammy on the Big River Blues?
Rolling Back to Mammy on the Big River Blues?
That's it! He's got it! He's got it!
Now, don't be too hasty. Perhaps I can think of something better. What about a folk song?
A folk song! I've got just the number for you. Listen to this.
Oh, you're gonna like this, Chiz. This is Back to the Good Earth, full of sweet. Play that, Danny.
What's it called?
Hold Down the Bayou. You hear that? That's New Orleans.
I visited there 3 weeks. I don't recognize it.
You don't?
Well, that's the spirit of New Orleans. I can almost smell the Delta.
I can smell the Delta. Can't you smell the Delta?
I have a slight cold.
Well, nothing that your mandolin won't cure. You pick this up, Chiz. Pick it up, boy.
Yeah. Come on, son. The train won't wait.
That's it. Now we're sailing up that river. Under Memphis, Chattanooga. Hold on, Chiz.
Hear them steamboat whistles blowing? Tote that barge. Pull that bale. There's a cabin in the cotton. Solid south. A solid north. Solid Jack.
Solid Jack?
Right. Wagon wheels are creaking westward. Now we're rolling past that junction. On to Kansas. Cincinnati.
Cincinnati, my hometown.
His hometown. Your hometown. Everybody's hometown. Cincinnati.
Boys, words fail me. I must see Shaw at once.
That's the spirit, yes. Chisholm. Whoa. Don't let America down.
You sure it's my duty as a backer?
You can do anything.
Anything?
Certainly.
Well, all right. I'll not only see that this epic-making number of yours is given the finest presentation in the world, but I'll go further.
Yes?
Well, I'll play in it myself, on my mandolin.
What?
Our rhythm and letter B, I'll give you a downbeat and set the tempo. At C, trombones make a very definite entrance. Saxes come in good and strong, and strings pick it up from there.
Oh, Ellen, can you ever forgive me?
Oh, Lester.
I know I don't deserve it. I've let you down in more ways than one. But I'm going to make up for it right now. Shaw, can I see you a minute?
Hi. Take 10, fellas. Hello, Mr. Chisholm. Glad you dropped in.
I didn't just drop in, Mr. Shaw. Sit down, please. And you, Ellen. Now, I realize I've shirked my duties, but I've got something to make up for. A folk song for the concert. It'll kill you.
Folk song?
It's got everything. The sweep of the prairies, creaking of wagons, the Mississippi.
Sounds peachy.
It goes like this. Da 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 da. Hold down the bayou. Can't you smell the Delta? Chattanooga, Louisiana, solid north, solid south. Hold down, boy. Ooh. That's the steamboat whistle. That's my hometown. It's your hometown. Everybody's hometown. Cincinnati.
Are you kidding?
It'll sweep the country. I insist that you play it at the concert.
Well, if that's the way you feel about it, you can... Prairies, wagons, steamboat whistles.
That's its sweep.
Listen, Artie, I've heard part of it, and it's not a bad song.
How can I tell from that? Get me someone who can play it.
I'll get you the composer himself. He's right outside. Right away.
I fixed it.
Good boy, Chiz. You done a great job.
Go in there and give him all you got.
Right.
Wait a minute. Maybe we better explain about our secret. I could back you up on the mandolin.
No. Save it. You don't want to give away the big surprise.
No, practice comes first. Besides, you're no song plugger.
Would Heifetz go around selling songs to band leaders?
That's right. I'll stand by and explain it as you play it.
No, we better stay out here, Chiz. You see, too many people might make Shaw nervous.
Well, I might be needed.
Come on down the lobby. I'll buy you a cigar.
I don't like cigars.
Don't you worry about it. I'll smoke it myself.
Artie, he'll be here in a minute.
I know, but I'm holding up a whole rehearsal, Ellen.
Hello, Mr. Shaw.
Oh, it's you again, huh?
I guess so.
Artie, you aren't going to let something that's over and done with stand in the way of a good song.
Okay, let's hear it. This better be good.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chisholm played on the mandolin, but he couldn't win, 'cause he tried to swing and he broke a string every time. Poor Mr. Chisholm just couldn't dig the jive. When he did arrive at the proper note, he arrived by boat every time. He tried to jazz up his mandolin, but never could quite control it. He always brought Bach and Handel in. When he took a lick, he always broke a pick. Poor Mr. Chisholm, you're quite a gay old blade. With your serenade, but your corny jack better truck on back to Dubuque. Get a uke. You disgrace your kin on the mandolin every time.
Did you like the tune, Artie?
Kind of cute. Tell you what you do. Make an arrangement of it, and maybe we can find a spot for it. But remember, no trouble this time.
Don't worry, Mr. Shaw, and thanks a lot.
Mr. Chisholm playing a mandolin, that'd really be something. All right, Ben, call the boys.
I'm within the hour. Chisholm is back. I'm making an arrangement. You see, Ellen, I've settled down. The merry-go-round's out.
Out nothing. You just happened to get the brass ring. This is your big chance, Danny.
I hope.
Did he understand it?
Did he call for it?
Hook, line, and Cincinnati.
Dice going, boy.
Wonderful. Calls for a celebration.
Atta boy, Danny.
Well, fellow artists, I'll give you the concert.
We accept it.
Lester, we're proud of you.
Oh, come, come, Ellen. I'm only the backer.
But that's a very important role, Lester.
Well, it's not as though I was a real contributor, as though I were one of the performers.
Well, now, look, we just about killed this bottle. What kind of a host are you? How about a refill?
Oh, excuse me. Of course, of course. Oh, you won't tell her while I'm gone.
Not a chance.
Don't worry about it.
Lester, wait a minute. Tell me what?
Well, it's just a little surprise. All that's tell her, fellas. I'm gonna play in the concert.
Lester, you're not.
But I am. I knew you'd be delighted. What am I standing here for? Wine is what we need. Wine.
So the merry-go-round's still on, huh?
We couldn't help it. All we did was flatter him a bit. If we disillusioned him, he'd call the whole thing off.
What do you suppose Shaw will do?
Shaw will never find out. Hank's gonna keep Chisholm away from him.
Me? Oh, no.
Oh, but I'll be busy with my arrangement.
All right, I'll make a bargain with you. You get me a job with Shaw with a nice fat trumpet part, and I'll look after Chisholm.
Oh, sure, I'll do my best.
You'll do better than that, or else.
Thank you. get it, Artie?
Oh, it was wonderful, Artie.
Glad you liked it.
Here's my arrangement.
Oh, fine. You make all the changes we talked about?
Yeah, but I don't know how good it'll sound after that. Artie, there's one little favor I want to ask you. You're going to use some extra trumpets. I know a fella that...
Oh, now, wait a minute. Not that partner of yours. Like, I can't get through a number without falling off the stand. Nothing doing. Period. We'll run over this in the morning.
Oh, Danny, what are we going to do about poor Hank?
It's going to be tough, but we'll keep on trying.
96. 7, 2, 3. 98, 2, 3. 99, 2, 3. And 100, and stop.
100 times without a slip.
No, no. You were pretty fuzzy there on 37. You were a quarter of a beat off on 76. Now, you take one more 100 and we'll turn it.
No, no. It's just 2 days before the concert. I better go down and tell Artie our secret.
No, not yet. It's too late tonight, anyhow.
No, it isn't. The band's staying late to rehearse.
You haven't practiced enough.
I practiced for 10 days, 12 hours a day, 6 hours a night. I'll go stale.
Are you ready? One, two.
Tonight at 8:30, Artie Shaw will present an interesting newcomer to the musical world. Interesting newcomer? That must mean me.
Huh? Yeah, sure.
What's the matter, Henry? You worried about the rehearsal?
Me, no. Is it worrying you?
Not at all. You know, there are very few troubles that a good night's sleep won't cure.
Look, you watch your own health. I got insomnia.
Insomnia? That's too bad. You should,
Come in.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chisholm.
Hello. Well, what about a drink?
Good idea.
I'll be right back. I just want to spruce up a bit.
Hello. Give me the Majestic Theater, will you? It's better so.
What? What's that? What about it? Yeah?
Wait a minute. Excuse me, will you, Chiz? This is personal matter, you know?
Say, Danny, you wouldn't lie to me at a time like this, would you?
It's all set, I tell you. You're in. You gotta get down here right away.
Makes up for things, Danny. What, Chisholm?
Wait a minute.
Don't you worry about Chisholm. I just got a plan to keep him here. You bet. So long.
The good news?
Well, depends on your point of view. One man's drink is another man's poison.
Yeah. Well, Henry, everything happens for the best. You know, it's always darkest just before dawn.
That's right. The lad worthwhile is the lad who can smile when the rest of the world's gone wrong.
Right as rain.
Yeah.
We'll have it over here. Henry, if ever anything comes between us, always remember I had your best interest at heart.
That cuts both ways, partner. Well, happy days.
Happy dreams. Bottoms up.
Bottoms up.
Some answer.
Well, never mind. I can't raise Hank anywhere. Ellen, I don't suppose you'll ever believe I didn't have anything to do with this.
Last week, I'd been sure you had. But this week, no. You know, you're improving so amazingly, Danny. I think I'll make you my manager.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we have a little blues number, which recently came to my attention bearing the somewhat ambiguous title, Hold Down the Bayou. Since then, it has grown up and been transformed into something rather special. Before playing it, I'd like to introduce the young man who wrote it, Danny O'Neill.
Go on.
That's it.
All right.
Okay. It's all yours. Looks like I'm going to have to hire you after all.
Thanks, Artie.
But only because I don't want to lose a good secretary. No, Bobby.
99. 100. Take it again.
There is room for a dog who adores you.
Was good?
Was perfect.
Mm-hmm.
The Elmwood is St. Louis Park's new apartment building. Designed for those 55 and better, it offers maintenance-free living so you can get out and enjoy your life and spend time doing what matters most. The Elmwood is located at 5605 West 36th Street in St. Louis Park. For information or to thank them for their sponsorship of this class, call 952-999-0023 or email Elmwood at APTSbymainstreet.com. You can also visit them at www.elmwoodliving.com. Hope you enjoyed our show today, but I hope it brought back some nice memories to you, and you had a lot of fun with the comedy, dancing, music, and I hope you'll come to Lenox Community Center when they reopen for the film series. It's once a month, and we'll have some rare feature films as well as rare newsreels, shorts, cartoons, previews of coming attractions. And so all of you out there, I wish you good health and stay well.